Siqueiros, one of the 20th century's most important innovators in painting techniques, is also one of the most versatile and controversial personalities in contemporary Mexican art and one of the world's greatest muralists. An artist with a warrior's temperament or a warrior with an artist's soul, Siqueiros regarded his life and his painting as a battle that had to be waged on two fronts, both within himself and against the injustice in his world. He espoused the Stalinist version of Lenin Marxism with the same fervor as he loved his women or took up arms during the Mexican Revolution and the Spanish Civil War. A man prone to excesses and explosive outbursts, a performer born to act out an impassioned self-role, he stood by his ideas to the point of dogmatism and violence. With the same recklessness as he had fought on the Republican front in Spain, he led an armed attack against Leon Trotsky in Mexico, only 3 months before the Soviet leader's assassination. Like his art, his personality was charged with contrasts, chiaroscuros, and an indomitable power of expression. A revolutionary and talented creator, Siqueiros lived, painted, and fought with passion. Passion, the color of fury. José Alfaro Siqueiros was born in Santa Rosalia, now Ciudad Camargo in the Mexican state of Chihuahua, on December 29, 1896. He was the second child of Cipriano Alfaro, a prosperous and deeply Catholic lawyer, and Teresa Siqueiros, who died when José was only 4. Consequently, he spent most of his time with his paternal grandparents. Father and son were poles apart. Don Antonio Alfaro was liberal and anti-clerical. He had fought on the side of the reforming president Benito Juarez against the conservatives and the temporary emperor of Mexico, Maximilian von Habsburg. A lover of alcohol with a flair for telling real and improvised stories, he gave his grandson a severe education that would mark him for life. Siqueiros revealed his artistic vocation from the age of 11 when he did this oil copy of Raphael's Virgin of the Chair. Maternity became one of the constant themes in his work from this time forward. His rebellious spirit already emerged as a student, and his vocation as a military man appeared when he enlisted in the army of the victorious leader of the Mexican Revolution, Venustiano Carranza. He was 18 years of age. Undoubtedly, his direct military involvement in the Mexican Revolution was the cornerstone of his conception of modern painting in Mexico. From this emerged the soldier artist, the warrior painter. After the victory of the Constitutionalist Army in 1917, he moved to the city of Guadalajara, where he met other revolutionary painters whom he called, with exaggerated eloquence, the Congress of Soldier Artists. Many years earlier, even before he had posed the problem of socially committed art, he had painted this pastel entitled Peasants, which bears the Alfaro signature and reveals the influence of his teacher, the painter Saturnino Herrán. At that time, he began to show his talent as a portrait painter. His first two self-portraits come from this period, as does his watercolor of Anna Pavlova, entitled Dance of Rain. In recognition of his services, he was sent as military attaché in the Mexican embassy in Spain with his wife, Graciela Amador. It was she who convinced him to change his name from José to David and to use his mother's surname, Siqueiros, instead of Alfaro, his father's name. Deported from Spain for political activities, he went to France and made contact with the avant-garde Mexican artist Diego Rivera in Paris. This was a decisive meeting for the future of Mexican art. While Rivera told him about European art, Siqueiros spoke of his experiences during the Mexican Revolution. Rivera introduced him to Léger and Braque. In Italy, he was greatly impressed by the monumental works of art of the Renaissance masters. The Giotto, Masaccio, and Michelangelo frescoes amazed him. However, he was most interested in the work of the Italian futurists, Russolo, Carrà, Marinetti, Boccione, and Severini. He felt particularly drawn to the futurists' principle of dynamism, and above all, to their claim to paint movement. The influence of the metaphysical school of Giorgio de Chirico is seen in this portrait of Kennedy the tailor. In 1921, he published a manifesto, which in his own words was the first call to create monumental, heroic, human, and public art which we could learn directly from the living example of the spectacular pre-Hispanic cultures in America. But what means would we use to create this monumental, heroic, public art? The answer was mural painting. This is the first theoretical proposal put forward by Siqueiros and the Mexican muralist movement. After a long sojourn in Europe, Siqueiros was enticed back to Mexico in 1922 by the Minister of Education, José Vasconcelos, who had planned the most ambitious cultural project in the history of Mexico. The building of the National Preparatory School of San Ildefonso became the first plastic laboratory of a new artistic venture, the Mexican muralist movement. In light of the revolutionary mood of the time, it might seem odd that the predominant theme in the first murals painted by Diego Rivera, José Clemente Orozco, and others here was religious. Siqueiros chose the walls of the stairway in the Patio Chico. On the vault of the stairs, he painted his first mural using the encaustic technique and called it The Elements. Even in these early works, Siqueiros met the challenge of integrating the painted design with the architecture. On the landing of the second floor, he painted his first socially committed mural, Burial of a Workman. The faces and the hieratic attitudes reflect traits of pre-Hispanic Olmec art. During these years, Siqueiros was already combining the two driving forces in his life, art and politics. As General Secretary of the emerging Union of Revolutionary Painters, Sculptors, and Engravers, he wrote a manifesto in which he stated, We repudiate so-called easel painting and all art in an ultra-intellectual vein as aristocratic, and we extol monumental art expression as being of public benefit. By 1929, following further tension and rebellion in Mexico, the Great Depression in the United States, and the rift between Trotsky and Stalin after Lenin's death in the Soviet Union, Siqueiros had been appointed General Secretary of the Mexican Communist Party, and later of the United Trade Union Confederation of Mexico. As leader of the Mexican workers, he was sent to Montevideo, where he met the writer Blanca Luz Brum. They went to Argentina to attend the Second Latin American Communist Congress, at which Siqueiros exhorted them to take up arms. He was arrested and deported from Argentina. Upon their return to Mexico, Siqueiros broke off his relationship with Graciela Amador, his partner and comrade of 11 years. In 1930, Siqueiros was arrested and imprisoned when the new Mexican president was wounded by a would-be assassin on the day he came to power. He spent several months in Lecumberri prison before being transferred under police vigilance to the mountain town of Taxco. He was also expelled from the Mexican Communist Party for his relationship with Blanca Luz Brum, because it was suspected that her sympathies lay with Trotsky. In Taxco, Siqueiros returned to art. He struck up friendship with the Soviet film director Sergei Eisenstein, who was working in Mexico. In under a year, he painted more than 100 canvases, many of which were outstanding and revealed not only his commitment to the underprivileged sectors of Mexican society, but also his irrefutable artistic talent. Some of these works were included in his famous one-man show in the Spanish Casino in Mexico City. They were hailed by both critics and poets for their power and fervor. One of them wrote, "This vision invades us and delves deep, stirring us and touching the strings of our innermost being." Eisenstein commented, "Siqueiros is the best proof that the really great painter must, above all, take a social stance and have ideological conviction. The greater the conviction, the greater the painter. Siqueiros is a wonderful synthesis of emotional discharge and disciplined intellect." The exhibition organizer, Anna Brenner, said, "While maintaining a perfect balance, he has maximized the ideological, emotional, and aesthetic unity which Mexican art represents and which can only be called genius." Because of Siqueiros' refusal to accept his restriction order, the Mexican authorities put him in a predicament. Either he should return to prison or leave the country. He decided to go to Los Angeles, California, where he worked as a teacher in the Chouinard School of Art. This proved to be a watershed in his artistic career. He started to experiment with new techniques and materials and to express his ideology in his murals. The first mural he painted there was on the outer wall of the Chouinard School. Its theme was a workers' meeting. The content of the mural was considered subversive, especially because it was set in the historical context of the economic depression in the United States. It was thus erased a year later. Siqueiros and the mural block painters he founded were a powerful group in artistic circles in Los Angeles, and they were invited to paint a mural at the Plaza Art Center. The theme, Tropical America, was decided upon by the owners of the property. What would have been in the hands of another artist a landscape painting took in Siqueiros' hands an unexpected turn. The mural was painted on the outer wall of the second floor of the building on Olvera Street, in the heart of the Mexican Quarter of Los Angeles. This posed a threefold challenge: aesthetic, political, and technical. The work was aesthetically highly significant. It gave concrete form for the first time to his idea of multi-angular perspective conceived, as in the case of billboards or outdoor advertisements, for the moving spectator. As a political project, it expressed his anti-imperialist stance by depicting in the center of the composition the figure of a crucified Indian threatened by the American eagle. On the upper right-hand side, two armed peasants stand ready to attack. The voluptuous exuberance of the rainforest, decorated with elements from Mayan art, encircles the central figure. A monumental work, sensual and subversive, at a Baroque moment. As regards technique, Siqueiros, taking the advice of the American architect Richard Neutra, painted on a white concrete surface, which required the use of industrial instruments and materials, such as spray gun, an electric projector, a lineograph, and automobile paint. This mural, Siqueiros declared, made me change all my methods to pursue modern technology as it accords with modern art depicting social themes. This new technique became the basis of his new aesthetics. Art should be revolution itself. Tropical America was also victimized. On two occasions, it was covered with white paint. If to this we add its continual exposure to the sun, rain, pollution, and earth tremors, it is easy to understand why many specialists thought it had been destroyed. In 1987, the Getty Conservation Institute launched a scientific project to salvage the mural. In spite of all the effort on the part of the Getty Institute, Tropical America will, unfortunately, never be restored to its original grandeur, since a lot of the color had been lost on account of its protracted exposure to the elements and to vandalism. The artistic power of Siqueiros' work will, however, have been salvaged for future generations. Before being deported from the United States, Siqueiros painted another mural in Santa Monica, in the house of the film director Dudley Murphy. Executed in fresco in 1932, this work was called Present Portrait of Mexico. It depicts a revolutionary president of Mexico and combines images of corruption, repression, and poverty. On the wall to the right, the threat of rebellion, an armed guerrilla. The portrait of Mexico painted then is still true today. Once deported, Siqueiros left for South America. The threat of imprisonment prevented him from returning to Mexico. It was in Montevideo that he discovered the material that transformed his painting technique and would be his trademark from that time on. The industrial paint Duco, or pyroxylin, a cellulose nitrate compound. Proletarian Victim, the first picture he painted using this new technique, is a masterpiece. From Montevideo, he traveled to Buenos Aires, where he was invited to give a series of three conferences, but the first was so explosive that the other two were suspended. In prison, yet again, he was released under the condition that he would abstain from all political activity. In the bar of a house, Siqueiros painted the mural Plastic Exercise. expelled from Argentina for attending a workers' meeting. Blanca Luz Brun left him. During a visit to Mexico, Siqueiros fell in love with Maria Asunsolo and painted two splendid portraits of her, one as a child and the other as a woman descending the stairs. Attend the Congress of the Artists of America, he set up the Siqueiros Experimental Workshop in 1936 for the dual purpose of backing the North American Communist Party in the forthcoming presidential elections and of experimenting with pyroxylin, the spray gun, photography, the chemistry materials, and the superimposition of colors by absorption. One of the students at the workshop was Jackson Pollock, the creator of action painting and a central figure in American abstract expressionism, upon whom Siqueiros was, indisputably, an influence. It was at this time that Siqueiros developed his theory of the controlled accident, absorbing two or more superimposed colors which produce fantasies and magical forms, something similar to the geological formation of the earth, he wrote, and above all, a tumultuous dynamism, a tempest, a physical and social revolution that is terrifying at times. Between 1935 and 1937, Siqueiros combined these discoveries and the use of photography to create pictorial works that evoked an apocalyptic vision of the world. The birth of fascism, executed in two stages, was done during this period. In the first, fascism takes the form of a three-headed monster with the faces of Hitler, Randolph Hearst, and Mussolini. One can also see the Statue of Liberty sinking into the sea. In both versions, the promised land is the Soviet Union. This image would never change in the Siqueiros ideology. During this period, he also painted Echo of a Scream, inspired by a newspaper photograph of the war between China and Japan, in which a Chinese child is crying her heart out. This masterpiece, in new realism, blends human grief with beauty. However, denouncing fascism in painting was not enough for the warrior artist Siqueiros. So he went to fight on the Republican front during the Spanish Civil War. He was promoted from staff officer to lieutenant colonel, commanding two brigades. One of his final war missions was to cross the border into fascist Italy to get hold of a manual outlining the plans of Mussolini's military strategy to support Franco. Like all his other military responsibilities, he executed this one with a nearly suicidal temerity. He considered art as a battle weapon and stated, "To me, there is no beauty comparable to military action, not even art, for which I have dedicated my life." During the Spanish Civil War, the definitive rupture in relations between Stalin and Trotsky took place, which finally led Trotsky to seek and be granted political asylum in Mexico through Diego Rivera and Frida Kahlo's presentation of the case to President Lázaro Cárdenas. Trotsky's exile in Mexico infuriated Siqueiros and opened one of the darkest chapters in the painter's life. Upon his return to Mexico in 1939, Siqueiros found his country in a difficult political position following the nationalization of the oil companies. Trotsky's presence in Mexico exacerbated the climate of tension. In this climate, Siqueiros was invited to paint a mural in the headquarters of the Mexican Electricians Union. The space assigned for it was a small staircase, 4.90 meters high by 3.30 meters wide and 3.80 meters deep, to which Siqueiros created an astonishing monumentality on account of his use of multi-angular perspectives. The work is called Portrait of the Bourgeoisie and depicts, according to the author and his collaborators, the process of the death of capitalism. The mural speaks for itself. Although a painted version of his ideology, it reveals amazing power, complexity, and flamboyance. This mural gave birth to the group of the Tres Grandes, the triumvirate of Mexican painting: José Clemente Orozco, Diego Rivera, and David Alfaro Siqueiros. At 4 a.m. on May 25, 1940, before Siqueiros had completed his mural at the Electricians Union, 20 men dressed as policemen and armed with machine guns surprised the guards at Trotsky's fortress house in Coyoacán in Mexico City. The intruders disarmed them, tied them up, cut the telephone line and the alarm link with police headquarters, took up the positions in the garden and began to shoot at Trotsky's bedroom. He and his wife, Natalia, may have been hiding under the bed. The attempt only lasted a few minutes, but over 300 shots were fired. However, Trotsky, Natalia, their nephew Seva, and the guards were not wounded. The architect and leader of this attempt was David Alfaro Siqueiros, who considered it one of the most honorable acts of his life, an instance not so unusual at the time of moral and intellectual confusion caused by ideological passion. 3 months later, Trotsky was assassinated. Siqueiros' involvement in this crime is still disputed today, even though at the time of the murder, he was living as a fugitive from justice in the state of Jalisco and working as a peasant. Siqueiros was detained for his part in the latter conspiracy against Trotsky and for the murder of the head guard. 6 months later, he was released on bail, and at the proposal of President Manuel Ávila Camacho, who owed him a favor from their years as revolutionary soldiers, Siqueiros went into voluntary exile in Chile. His friendship and ideological affinity with the poet Pablo Neruda, then Chilean consul in Mexico, enabled him to obtain a visa. In 1941, in the Chilean city of Chillán, which had been destroyed by an earthquake, the Mexican government had built a school, and Siqueiros painted a mural there. The mural, which employs the technique of pyroxylene paints, is called Death to the Invader. In it, Siqueiros relates the struggle for liberty of the Chilean and Mexican peoples. The mural is a Siqueirosian Baroque, described by Lincoln Kirstein, the former curator of the Museum of Modern Art in New York, as the most extraordinary visual experiment since the Camera Oscura, designed by Leonardo da Vinci. After the outbreak of World War II, after 4 years' absence, Siqueiros returned to Mexico in 1944 and almost immediately began to work on Cuauhtémoc against myth. In this mural, he depicted the last Tlatoani, or king of the Aztecs, defying a centaur. The mural was seen by Rita Hayworth and Orson Welles, who declared that no artist since Michelangelo had painted with such boldness within an architectonic space. The magnificent architecture of the Palacio de Bellas Artes in Mexico City houses three of Siqueiros' best-known murals. The central panel of the triptych depicts New Democracy as a female figure, her torso nude and strikingly virile, rising from the crater of a volcano. His last wife, Angélica Arenal, posed for this. She wears a Phrygian cap of liberty and an expression of ecstasy and hope as she has broken the chains of oppression. At her side, a foreshortened dead figure symbolizes the victory over Nazism. After the victory of the Allies over Nazism, Fascism, and the Japanese Empire, Siqueiros painted the side panels. In Victims of War to the left, the dramatic depiction of two foreshortened, dismembered figures lying prostrate on the staircase recalls the famous scene from the battleship Potemkin. In Victims of Fascism, a bound figure showing his lacerated back depicts torture. The three panels were painted in pyroxylene on Celotex back canvas. In 1945, after publishing his book, There Is No Other Route But Ours, Siqueiros began to paint a mural in the beautiful Spanish colonial building of Santo Domingo, in the center of Mexico City, which was completed 11 years later. Once again, Siqueiros mastered the challenge of integrating the painting with the architectural space on a large staircase with a high vault and two adjoining patios. When Rivera saw these figures, he said that Siqueiros had turned the wall into a rat's nest. On the vault, he painted a geometric design, and on the other vertical wall, a simplified portrait of a heroine of the Mexican independence movement. The work, which could have been one of Siqueiros' finest, owing to the magnificent architectonic space, remained in an inconclusive experimental stage. Another unfinished experiment, also of great aesthetic interest, is his mural in the former convent of La Concepción in San Miguel Allende, in the southern state of Guanajuato. A beautiful vaulted space measuring 17 meters long by 7 meters wide and 6 meters high serves Siqueiros' purpose of giving a practical course on mural painting, which he later turned into his book, How to Paint a Mural. In 1950, Mexico was invited for the first time to the Biennale of Venice. Siqueiros, Orozco, Rivera, and Tamayo represented the country. Siqueiros was awarded the second international prize. Henri Matisse got the first prize. Siqueiros exhibited the following works: Peasant Mother, Ethnography, Echo of a Scream, The Sob, Our Present Image. An eminent French critic commented, "Mexican art is the most exciting discovery of the Biennale. We come face to face with a totally original creation which has evolved beyond the reach of European influences and which imposes itself with such violence that it is impossible to resist." Intertropic, Three Squashes, Pedregal with Figures, The Devil in the Church, the self-portrait Coronelazo, Portrait of Angelica. Another European critic wrote, "Siqueiros is a man of excesses as much in his life as in his art. He presents art as an attack and a violation. Never in the history of art have means of optical illusion been used with such effect as in the Centaur of the Conquest, Portrait of Margarita Urrueta, and Cain in the United States." Upon his return to Mexico, Siqueiros painted his two other murals in the Palacio de Bellas Artes. The Torture of Cuauhtémoc shows the last Aztec king stoically resisting torture. Below, the figure of a young girl with mutilated arms dates the work in its allusion to the Korean War in 1951, the year the mural was executed. In the accompanying panel, the apotheosis of Cuauhtémoc, the Aztec king, has defeated the Centaur of the Conquest and is dressed in the armor of the Spanish conquistadors. In Mexico City's National Polytechnic Institute, Siqueiros painted Man, the Master, Not the Slave of the Machine on a concave surface made of aluminum. 21 years after the exhilarating experience of outdoor work in Los Angeles, one of Siqueiros' dreams came true. He was invited to paint a mural on the facade of an automobile company in Mexico City. This was a polychrome relief of sculpture painting covered in part by glazed tiles and mosaics, which he called Speed. In the hallway of the Social Security Hospital de la Raza in Mexico City, Siqueiros fulfilled another of his pictorial dreams, to paint a mural on a continuous surface in which the ceiling and the walls were unified by means of an ovoid curve. The theme of the mural, public health for all Mexicans, is didactic. When the spectator walks along, he becomes a protagonist in the mural because the figures appear to move with him. On the outside wall of the Rectory Tower at University City in Mexico City, Siqueiros executed three murals. The artist Juan O'Gorman, a contemporary of Siqueiros, regarded these works as a setback for Mexican visual arts, since apart from the totally incomprehensible theme, the architecture and the painting design were not integrated but opposed. With his customary verbal dexterity, Siqueiros described O'Gorman's work of the university library as an American gringa dressed up as an Indian peasant woman. After visits to the Soviet Union and China, Siqueiros painted a mural entitled Apology of the Future Victory of Medical Science Over Cancer, and subtitled Historical Parallelism of the Scientific Revolution and the Social Revolution. In Siqueiros' stated view, the mural displays a primitive community whose only response to illness is imploring their gods for mercy. A male figure leaps from that prehistoric age towards the feats of liberty and knowledge which constitute the history of man. It was only through the solidarity both of different peoples and of manual and intellectual workers that the first advances in medical science were made. In the National History Museum at Chapultepec in Mexico City, Siqueiros painted the mural of From Porfirism to the Revolution. The first panel of the mural depicts the martyrs of the miners' strike at Cananea, one of the incidents preceding the Mexican Revolution. The pre-Hispanic pyramid in the corner solves the problem of the right angle formed by the two walls. The image of a peasant on horseback, in dramatic perspective, represents the force behind the eruption of the popular revolt. The next section depicts the revolutionaries in arms. On the following wall, the people joined the struggle guided in a moment of excessive historical license by Marx, Bakunin, and Proudhon. The other walls display the Mexican dictator Porfirio Díaz. Siqueiros, like his colleague Rivera, painted a pseudo-Marxist version of Mexican history in his official murals done for a government that was anything but communist. It is also true that, in retrospect, Siqueiros' vision of history might appear simplistic, schematic, and dogmatic. Nonetheless, the mural radiates such indisputable plastic force that it makes an immediate impact on, and even moves, the most critical spectator. On November 24, 1957, Diego Rivera died. The National Association of Actors had invited Rivera to paint a mural in the foyer of the Jorge Negrete Theater, but his illness had prevented him from starting it. Siqueiros was then invited to take over the commission. His version of dramatic art in the social life of Mexico was very different from that which Rivera had executed years earlier on the facade of a theater in Mexico City. On the main mural, Siqueiros chose not to paint the history of theater in Mexico, but rather the repression of a workers' demonstration. In artistic terms, the powerful expressiveness of the mural creates a dramatic effect. However, it was not what the Actors' Union had expected. Consequently, the mural was covered and Siqueiros was sued. When the work was eventually uncovered after 8 years, Siqueiros painted on the opposite wall a figure of the singer and actor Jorge Negrete and a number of other performers in an expressionist style which struck a vein of sarcasm and humor. In 1960, Siqueiros went to Venezuela to give some talks on art. The day before Adolfo López Mateos, the president of Mexico, arrived on an official visit, Siqueiros made some typically inflammatory declarations to the Venezuelan press. Several months later, Siqueiros was imprisoned on the charges of sedition, illegal possession of a firearm, resistance to lawful authority, and anti-governmental propaganda. His case was tried 17 months later. Siqueiros' arrest was condemned both in Mexico and abroad. Picasso organized a committee for his defense in France, and 200 artists demonstrated against his imprisonment in front of the United Nations building in New York. The Chilean poet Pablo Neruda wrote, "Mexico is a captive with you." Siqueiros petitioned the Mexican government to release him so that he might complete mural projects on several public buildings throughout the country. After 4 years, they eventually agreed to his terms. More than 500 people were awaiting him as he left prison. Amidst flowers and singing of the Internacional, they bore him on their shoulders to his car. The most ambitious and probably the most controversial project Siqueiros undertook as an artist was the Polyforum Cultural Siqueiros in Mexico City. The idea was to create an architectonic space which could be painted on both the inside and the outside. Siqueiros' dream was to form a complete unity in which there would be no distinction between architecture, sculpture, and painting. The painted outer surface and the painted inner surface are more than triple the size of Michelangelo's Sistine Chapel. On the inside of the Polyforum, Siqueiros' indomitable passion was put into full play upon creating a plastic metaphor which was called the March of Humanity in Latin America on Earth and towards the cosmos, misery and science. Siqueiros' own interpretation of this monumental work is as follows. The story of the mural begins on the southern side, which narrates the march of the Latin American peoples towards the bourgeois democratic revolution. A black sculpture of a mutilated figure who has been hanged, and a tortured and burnt figure who is ascending after death, represent the violence of slavery and racism. A sculpture of an animal known as Nahual in Aztec mythology symbolizes the forces of evil and ancestral prejudice. Despite the suffering, these peoples march on towards freedom, bearing the burden of their misery, but also the hope of maternal security. A clown-like demagogue tries to deceive them. Still dressed in rags, they express little enthusiasm for the Pyrrhic victory of the bourgeois democratic revolution won by armed struggle. On the western side of the oval, a stylized figure from the painting Our Present Image with his hands by his side, symbolizes the men of science and technology. Northern Wall relates the march of humanity towards its complete emancipation in the future. Violence takes the form, in this case, of an erupting volcano and of a Nahual attacking a woman. Next to this, a figure is feeling a poisonous tree, while the rest continue on their march through a desolate and dramatic landscape of arid desert and dead trees. A fake tree introduces a more positive symbol. Although it never flowers, it is coming to life once more, and two leaders sprout on its branches. A female figure represents the call to revolutionary struggle against social, economic, and cultural backwardness, exploitation, and injustice. On the eastern side of the oval, the female version of our present image, symbolizing culture, stretches out her hands to offer peace, harmony, and love in a new society. The third section of this monumental work consists of these two sides of the oval, which form a plastic unit with a vaulted ceiling where man's desire to conquer the cosmos is depicted. Entering the space of the March of Humanity is like going into a forest fire. The immensity of the space itself and the agglomeration of the images make it a source of wonder to all who see it. The great orchestration of the Poliforum is fortissimo. There are no silences or pauses. With the exception of the upper part of the mural, all is agitation and noise. This mural betrays Sicaro's personality, perhaps more than any other. It is his best and most honest self-portrait, vehemence made painting. The March of Humanity is David Alfaro Siqueiros. Notwithstanding his pretending disdain of easel painting, it is there where the best cicadas may be found. It is within the canvas where the substance of his painting, the expressionist force of his stroke, his use of light, or the perfect fusion of texture and color are plainly expressed. Beyond the rhetorical content of his murals, in his portraits, landscapes, women, still lives, as well as in his abstract works, Siqueiros discloses himself as an artist rather than as an ideologue. In many cases, he reaches an outstanding result. Siqueiros died of cancer on January 6, 1974. His involvement in such a wide range of activities throughout his life gives the impression that he was not one but several people. This soldier, revolutionary, union leader, actor, fighter against fascism and imperialism, Soviet agent, conspirator in an attempt on Trotsky and in the murder of his secretary, was also an adventurer, a political exile, a prisoner, an art theorist and critic, a writer and editor of pamphlets and magazines. Besides all this, he was a prolific painter of murals and individual works in which he shows both his innovations in pictorial technique and his creativity with forms, textures, perspectives, and colors that place him among the most expressive plastic artists of this century, not only in Mexico, but in the whole world.